I'm here today with Kim Pippa Tonnesen from Columbia College, and Kim teaches English online, and she's been through our OEI online course review process. And Kim is going to share with us something about her online class. Kim, what you're going to share with us is how you demonstrate alignment with A5, which is chunking, but then also talk a little bit about how that also falls into section D, which is accessibility. Is that right?
Right. Through going through the course review processes a few times now, I've learned so much about accessibility, and I didn't realize that my content pages were not accessible. I assumed that they were. So I really think it's important to just inform, educate people about why they need to set up their content pages in a certain way, because this does benefit all students in universal design. So that's just an element I think is really important.
Great. Well, I'm sure we're all going to learn from what you're going to share with us. Do you want to take us into your class?
Sure. All right. So we're talking about chunking. And first of all, I wanted to show you an example of what not to do with your text. So whenever you see a large block of information like this, it gets pretty hard to process. Fortunately, Canvas uses like a default spacing that's 1.5, so that does give it a little bit of white space here, but it's still a bit overwhelming to look at this much text and think about trying to absorb all of it. Now, if you think about visually impaired students who are using screen readers and the way a screen reader processes text, the screen reader will read the text from beginning to end with no breaks. Unless breaks are formatted into the page, the students don't have any time to stop and absorb information. So let's look at the same text that is chunked properly. Now you can see that this text is broken up into manageable pieces. Now there's a few different elements to think about when it comes to chunking. And the first is white space. And the reason that white space is important is because it gives readers visual clues as to when to stop and process information. So the three things you want to think about when you're creating a content page is, first of all, make sure the paragraphs are not too long. You can see I have some short little paragraphs, easy to absorb. The next thing is to make sure that your text is left justified. And this is because in the US, we are used to reading left to right, so our eyes just naturally gravitate to the left margin. And then also we want to use that default spacing in Canvas so that the spacing is at least 1.5. Another thing to consider is using headings, because they create stopping points throughout the page. I'll show you if you go into edit here. So Canvas automatically, the title is heading one. So any heading that you're going to add in your content page is going to start with heading two. And you want to make sure that these headings stay sequential or nested properly throughout the content page. If you don't do that, then screen readers, they're reading through it numerically. So you wouldn't want to jump from heading two to four and back to three, because it's not going to present the information in order for the screen reader. And the final element I wanted to show you is lists. So let's go down here to this page. So using lists lessens cognitive load because it enhances the use of textual and white space. And it also groups things conveniently, so it's easy to absorb as well. I thought I would show you the wrong way also to use a numbered list. And what we don't want to do is to say take a list and just start typing in what we want. Instead, we want to type our list and then highlight it, and then go up to the taskbar and use the appropriate tool here, either numbered or bulleted. And again, this is for ease of screen readers so that they will properly order the information for students to read. One last thing I wanted to show you about headings Now, I was also going to show you these overview pages as well. This was something that was commented on when I got my OEI review back, was that they're all structured the same way. So I have a weekly overview page, which lets students know what's going on, and they're all pretty much set up the same. They're also the same in my calendar. So that makes for ease of navigation for students, and they know what to expect each week. But I learned a handy tip from the accessibility designer when I was designing this page, because I didn't have a need for headers, since the text for the heading was in the image itself. And I did not know that you could use an image as a heading, but you can. You just have to label it instead of, it's going to be standard paragraph if you click on it, but you just need to make it a heading, and it will read like that for students when they're listening to it on a screen reader. So that's a quick handy tip. You can use your images for headings.
Can you show us while you're in here how to be sure that image has alt text on it so that the screen reader does read it as text? Because that's, I love that tip, but that's such a critical point.
Right. So you want to, I'm sorry, I'm automatically doing it without showing you. You want to highlight the image and then go to the embed image icon. And now these, a lot of times with the longer headings, I go into the HTML and do it. But if you, the hard way is to drag it over and to eliminate. Normally you're going to see at the end of an image, perhaps a .jpg like this. And you're going to have to just remove those final letters and period from it to make it accessible.
So in other words, we want that alt text to replicate the text in the image, right, so the screen reader can read it too.
Yeah, otherwise it's going to be reading the
perfect
other letters, which are unintelligible.
That is a really great tip.
Great.
A shout out to, was it Liesl who shared that tip with you?
Yes.
Liesl Madrona, one of our wonderful instructional designers on the At One and OEI team. Okay. Thanks, Kim. Thanks for sharing with us.
Thank you so much.